Grace and peace be to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I welcome you to this special Good Friday service. Many Good Friday services have readings of Jesus' seven sayings from the cross across the four different gospel accounts. Our service today is structured around one gospel account, the account of Luke. And you will hear the progression to the cross starting from Gethsemane through Jesus' trial and then his time on the cross. Since our pandemic safety protocols are not printed in today's bulletin, let me just share briefly about them so that we have a common understanding. Masks are optional while you are seated, unless you are seated in this far section back here. If you choose to be seated there, you're to be masked throughout. We do ask that all folks would be masked as you sing. I invite you now to stand as you are able to join with me in the call to worship. We who have known failure and defeat are summoned to walk with Jesus to Golgotha.
We who face weakness and temptation gather in the name of the one who overcame them.
Come to see and know the unique child of God who lived among us and died on our behalf.
Christ.
Let us come believing what the gospel teaches and acting on what is being revealed to us.
We trust Christ to help us grow in understanding heavenly purposes and redemptive action.
You may be seated. Please join me in prayer. O God, lead us through the account of Jesus' last hours as participants, not just as spectators. As we share the sorrow and distress Jesus knew, grant us the humble faithfulness to face our own challenges, bolstered by the example of your great love. Amen. At the Maundy-Thursday service last night, we remembered Jesus' Last Supper with his followers. We pick up the account at that point with a time of searching prayer at the Garden of Gethsemane, which was at the base of Mount of Olives, the site of his arrest. Now reading from Luke chapter 22, verses 39 through 53. Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you do not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet, not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?" When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike with a sword?" Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now we hear of the triple denial of Jesus by Peter, which Jesus had predicted earlier that evening. Reading Luke 22, 54 to 62. Then they seized Jesus and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "You also are one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then about an hour later, still another kept insisting, "Surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us join together in the prayer of confession. Good Shepherd, all we like sheep have gone astray. Our mouths have spoken deceit, and our easy acceptance of advantages have led to violence. We have fallen before temptation and have led others to stumble and fall. Before the law of love, our sins of omission are all too apparent. Our indifference adds to the evil intent that nailed Jesus to the cross. Of all this we repent, seeking the forgiveness we do not deserve. Save us, we pray. Look how far Christ goes to demonstrate love, even for those who reject him. Receive the great expressions of grace our Lord offers. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you.
Friends, even on this day, maybe especially on this day, the peace of Christ is offered to all who seek it. Let us share the peace of Christ with our neighbors. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Okay, you may be seated. Our next reading focuses on the beginning of the torturing of Jesus and then the period of time when Jesus was being questioned by the religious tribunal. Reading Luke 22:63-71. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him, "Prophesy, who is it that struck you?" They kept heaping many other insults on him. When day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said, "If you are the Messiah, tell us." He replied, "If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God." All of them asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He said to them, "You say that I am." Then they said, "What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips." The word of God.
We hear now of Jesus standing on trial before Roman officials, Pilate and Herod. We'll read from Luke 23:1-16. Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king." Then Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered, "You say so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no basis for an accusation against this man." But they were insistent and said, "He stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began, even to this place." When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been wanting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people, and here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death, and I will therefore have him flogged and release him." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. You may be seated. We hear now the demands of the gathered crowd regarding Jesus, the sentencing that would lead to his execution and then the journey to the place of crucifixion. Then the people all shouted out together, "Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us." This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" A third time he said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Join me in prayer. Faithful God, our Father, from a wandering nomad you created your family. For a hundred or for burdened people, you raised up a leader. For a confused nation, you chose a king. For a rebellious crowd, you sent your prophets. In these last days, you have sent us your Son, revealing your will, bringing your kingdom, redeeming your people for yourself. Continue to lead us in your way through Jesus Christ. You have opened our ears to hear your word and our lips to proclaim your truth. Open our eyes this day to see in the cross the revelation of your love through Jesus the crucified. Eternal God of unchanging power and light, look with mercy on your whole church. Bring to completion your saving work, so that the whole world may see the fallen lifted, the old made new, and all things brought to perfection by our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, be honor and praise now and forever. We pray in the name of Jesus who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen.
We now hear Luke's account of those being crucified along with Jesus and what is said from the cross. Reading Luke chapter 23, verses 32 through 43. Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by, watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We frequently focus on how Jesus lived and how he instructs us about how to live. Today we are getting a glimpse into how he died. Yes, we know that he was unjustly executed in what was intentionally a painful, humiliating, gruesome public demonstration to anyone who might be inclined to challenge the dominance of the Roman Empire. We know that those who were crucified were hung in such a way that they had to try to lift up their bodies a bit to catch a breath, and eventually they died of asphyxiation. But we hear in Luke's telling about what Jesus was focusing on as he suffered and as he faced his death. The four gospel accounts tell of seven statements Jesus made from the cross. Some Good Friday services focus on these seven statements, but today we are encountering the larger passion narrative from the Gospel of Luke. Here we find three of the seven statements Jesus uttered from the cross. The first is a prayer asking forgiveness for those around him. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Forgive them. Who is the them? Right before this, Luke tells us there were two criminals, one on his right and one on his left, also being crucified at the same time. Is he referring to these criminals and seeking forgiveness for them? Scriptural account suggests that Jesus is praying for a wider audience than that. For the sentence before Jesus expresses his prayer reads, when they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. That makes Jesus' prayer sound like it is at least for those who were directly involved with crucifying him. Earlier in Luke, we had heard Jesus' teaching, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. Then a few verses later, still in reference to enemies, he instructs, be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Even as Jesus is suffering and dying, he does as he taught others to do. He shows his love even for those who were killing him, prays for those abusing him, and demonstrates the same kind of mercy that God does. Right after the prayer, Luke mentions those who were casting lots for Jesus' clothing, along with people who were standing by watching, and leaders who were scoffing, and soldiers who were mocking Jesus. I dare say there's a strong case to be made that these people would also be included in Jesus' prayer when he asked, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And if his prayer included his followers who were at the crucifixion standing by watching, I think a case can be made that Jesus would also include in his forgiveness prayer those of his disciples and other followers who were too afraid or too confused or too fill in the blank to stand with him at this critical time. Jesus, given totally of himself in life and in death, is the ultimate example of godly, steadfast love and mercy. And we can ask that that love and mercy would apply also to us who have also rejected God and God's ways in multiple actions and inactions. In our reading, we also heard one of the criminals beside Jesus deriding him, saying, are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us. The other criminal rebukes his counterpart, distinguishing between their own justly deserved punishment and that of the innocent Jesus, and expresses his faith in Jesus by asking to be remembered when Jesus would come into his full reign. In response, Jesus goes beyond what is asked and promises that even that same day, he would enjoy fellowship with him in paradise. In the original Greek of the New Testament, the word paradisos occurs only three times, this being one of them. There's much written about heaven and paradise and other expressions of hope about life beyond our physical life in this realm. But here is implied that paradise is the place that after death receives the souls of those considered righteous. In his own dying hour, Jesus continues his saving ministry that exhibits God's grace. Even as they die, hope does not die. We have heard of the responses of the people who were present at the crucifixion. In what will be our final reading, we will also hear that Luke joins two other gospel accounts remarking on darkness coming over the land as Jesus is dying. It is presented as nature's response to the Son of God being executed. Then the temple curtain that separated the holiest of sections of the temple from the other parts is described as being torn in two. These two signs speak of the effect of Jesus' dying upon the whole earth and upon the central institution of religion. Even accomplished in a mournful way, the way of access to God through Jesus' actions is now available. We will also hear in that reading that Jesus' final words in Luke's crucifixion account express another prayer. This one articulating trust in God and the committing of his spirit into God's hands. It is a quote from the 31st Psalm. Once again, Jesus shows us, even at the most dire of times, that God is the one who can be trusted to provide the greatest peace in the narrow and the broad sense of that word. Even as we count on Jesus to guide us in our living by how he lived, we can also learn from him about how we are to live through what he did as he was dying. May you be enriched with the blessings of God's forgiveness and the promise of paradise, that they might increase your trust in God in ways that would benefit you now and even forevermore. Amen.
In our last reading, we now hear about our Lord's death and the entombment of his body. Reading Luke 23, 44 to 56. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, when the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly, this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for the spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of the preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come down with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb, and how his body had been laid. When they returned, they prepared spices and ointments. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.